Hello friends, in this lecture we are going to discuss about the biomass energy. The objective of this lecture is to know about the origin of biomass energy and recognize the importance of biomass as a useful source of renewable energy. Also we'll describe some technologies for conversion of raw biomass into useful form of energy. So in this lecture we are going to see basics of biomass energy, methods of obtaining energy from biomass. Then we'll look thermal gasification, principle of biomass, biogas generation, then constructional details of various biogas plants, then some factors affecting generation of biogas and methods of maintaining biogas. Then I have given one reference book here. It's a reference book by Professor B.H. Khan, Non-Conventional Energy Resources, McGraw-Hill, and 2018 is the third edition with me. So I will recommend all of you to go through this book. Also there is a book by Professor G.D. Rai on non-conventional energy sources. So you can refer to that book also. Now let's discuss a little bit about the biomass. I think you people are well familiar with biomass, but still we will revise a bit knowledge about the biomass. Biomass is a general term for living material like plants, animals, fungi and bacteria. Taken together, the earth biomass represents an enormous store of energy. It has been estimated that just 1/8 of the total biomass produced annually would provide all of humanity's current demand of energy. And since biomass can be regrown, it is potentially a renewable resource. The energy obtained from biomass is known as biomass energy. Animals feed on plants, plant grows through photosynthesis process. They use the solar energy. Thus, photosynthesis process is primarily responsible for generation of biomass energy. A small portion of solar radiation is captured and those are stored in the plant during the photosynthesis process. Therefore, it is an indirect form of the solar energy only. The average efficiency of photosynthesis conversion process from solar energy into biomass energy is around like 0.5 to 1% only. But ultimately this is a renewable source and the sun is the ultimate source of energy, right? So that's why we can say the biomass is also a renewable source of the energy and it's a byproduct of the solar energy. So as shown here, very first term, that is biomass, is the general term for living material, and biomass energy is energy obtained from the biomass. To use biomass energy, the initial biomass may be transferred by chemical or biological process to produce more convenient intermediate biofuel. And this biofuel means, I think you know that methane, then producer gas, ethanol and charcoal. Okay. On combustion, it reacts with oxygen to release heat, but the element of the material should be available for recycling in natural, ecological or agricultural processes. Although the fossil fuels have their origin in ancient biomass, they are not considered biomass by the generally accepted definition because they contain carbon that has been out of the carbon cycle for a very long time. Their combustion therefore disturbs the carbon dioxide contained in the atmosphere. Biomass, mainly in the form of wood, is mankind's oldest form of energy. It has traditionally been used both in domestic as well as industrial activities. Basically, by direct combustion. Okay. As industrial activities increase, the growing demand of energy depleted biomass natural reserves. The development of new, more concentrated and more convenient sources of energy had led to its replacement to a large extent by the other sources. However, it still plays a significant role in the supply of primary energy in many countries of the world. Though biomass energy share in primary energy supply for the industrialized countries is maybe not more than 3%, a number of developing countries still use a substantial amount of the biomass, and it mostly in the form of the non-commercial energy. You can see this biomass as shown here. The types of the biomass are something like the wood, which is the byproduct of the photosynthesis process, then the garbage, then different crops, then few alcoholic fuels, then landfill gases. These are all those types of the biomass. Right. If I talk little bit about this photosynthesis process, I think this process everybody is well understood in their high school physics only. that the solar radiation incident on the green plants and other photosynthesis organism performs two basic functions. Number one is temperature control for chemical reaction to proceed, and number two is the photosynthesis process. The fundamental conversion process in green plants is photosynthesis, which is the process of combining CO2 from the atmosphere with water plus light energy to produce oxygen and carbohydrates. These carbohydrates means like sugar, then starch, then cellulose, and probably the hemicellulose also. Okay, so they are ultimate source of most of our food and other necessity of the daily life, such as cloths, that is also we are getting from the cotton, then furniture which we are getting from the wood. Okay, so like this, the photosynthesis process is shown here. The water molecule, then this reaction I am talking about, that water is combined with the carbon dioxide in the presence of the solar energy, that is the radiant energy, and it gives the glucose and oxygen, right? So solar energy, that is the sun's energy in the form of the photons, that energy along with some water and carbon dioxide, it is getting converted to the glucose and oxygen. Now this energy is being stored in the form of this biomass, that is wood, right? And I think everybody is now well aware that energy conservation principle, it cannot be generated and cannot be destroyed. That's why the solar energy is stored in the form of this glucose and oxygen. This energy is stored in the biomass. Now our target is to use this biomass energy. We need to convert this biomass energy into the usable form. That usable form may be direct heat, that usable form may be the chemical fuel. Okay, so now in this entire lecture we are going to see this conversion process, how the chemical energy which is stored in the biomass can be extracted in the form of some most useful energy. Okay, now there are some advantages of this biomass also, and what are those advantages? So very first advantage is a renewable source of energy. The energy storage is inbuilt feature, right? Because if I talk about the say solar photovoltaics, then you require the semiconductor material to convert the energy, right? But if I talk about the biomass energy, energy is itself is stored, so that is the inbuilt feature. Okay, it is an indigenous source of the energy, which is requiring little or no foreign exchange, right? Then that we can say the pollutant emission from the combustion of biomass are usually lower than those of the fossil fuels, right? Then there is no seasonality type of the thing, just you need to store the biomass and use this energy, just only you need to ensure that there should be the proper conversion process of the biomass. Okay, so you open the book on the biomass energy, and you will see there are a lot of advantages and disadvantages of biomass energy are shown. Okay, so I think this is enough for the introduction of biomass. Now we are going to see what are those types of the biomass. Now in this slide we are going to see the usable forms of biomass. Biomass is, I think now you know, is organic material that reacts with oxygen in combustion and natural metabolic process to release the heat. So sometimes it is used as it is in the original form, but more often you need to transform it into the modern energy form, such as liquid and the gaseous fuel, then electricity and some process heat, and then it will provide the energy to the services needed by the rural and the urban population. Okay, and definitely by the industries. Now on this slide you can see there are seven types usable forms are shown, like fuel wood, then charcoal, then fuel pellets, then biodiesel, bioethanol, biogas and producer gas. So these are those seven most commonly usable forms of the biomass. Like if I talk about the fuel wood, as it is shown in the picture, the fuel wood, wood is the most obvious and the oldest source of the biomass energy. This was the main source of energy used by mankind for centuries. Direct combustion is the simplest way to obtain the heat energy from this wood. Okay, its energy density is around 16 to 20 megajoule per kg. It can also be converted to more useful forms such as like charcoal or the producer gas. About half of the world population depends on fuel wood or other biomass such as cow dung, then crop residue. And what are their usage? So most probably the use is cooking, okay, and some other domestic uses. Because of inefficient use of fuel, wood in the conventional household stove, so that what we call the chulhas, only 5% of the heat is utilized, and the remainder is lost due to wind, incomplete combustion, then radiation losses and other losses, and which resulting from the mismatch of the fire and the pot size. So this is what the inefficiency of the chulhas, what right now are being used countryside, right? So there is right now a few people are working to improve the efficiency of the chulhas. I would like to share one example that at CSIR Niri Nagpur, these people are these people have developed one efficient chulha, and I think the name is something like Nir Dhur. So this Nirdhur is the solar, sorry, not solar, it is the biomass chulha, which is having the very good efficiency. Okay, and now a few scientists, they are working on the CFD analysis of the chulha, that so that how they can improve the efficiency of this chulha, that the biomass can be efficiently converted to the heat energy, and that heat energy we can utilize for cooking application. Okay, so if somebody is interested, then we can go and we can see that what exactly this Nirdhur is. Okay, coming to second type, that is the charcoal. So charcoal is a clean and the smokeless dry solid fuel. This is of black color. It is shown here in the second picture. It has 75 to 80% of the carbon content and has energy density about 30 megajoule per kg. You see the comparison. In case of the fuel wood, it is 16 to 20 megajoule per kg. Means if I consider 1 kg of fuel wood, it will give me around 20 megajoule of energy. And instead, the charcoal, which is the again the product of your fuel wood, the energy density is higher. So if I consider 1 kg of charcoal, the energy will be around 30 megajoule. Okay, and it is obtained by carbonization process of woody biomass to achieve the higher energy density per unit mass, thus making it more economical to transport. It can be used as fuel in the domestic environment as it burns without smoke. In the industry sector, it is used in specialized application where specific fuel are required, okay, such as high carbon and the low sulfur content fuels are required. Okay, so that is the charcoal. Again, it's a product of wood by carbonization process. Then next usable form of this biomass energy is fuel pellets, or that we called as a briquettes. That is also the solid fuel. Okay, so crop residues such as like straw, then rice husk and the waste wood are pressed to form the lumps known as fuel pellets or briquettes, and we can use those as a solid fuel. Like you can see, this figure number 3 is the figure of that briquettes. We need to compress the biomass like wood and whatever I mentioned right now, the straws and the rice husk and all this crop residue, and then we need to compress it. We need to put some kind of binders into it, and we need to give some usable form. Okay, so like this, we are going to discuss this also, that what briquetting and how the pelletizing is done. So this is that fuel pellet, and definitely these are the solid fuel which is made up of all these kind of the wood and the crop residues. By compressing, it possesses the similar kind of the energy content. Okay, then coming to next form, that form we called as a biodiesel, and biodiesel means this is obtained from some vegetable oil. So this vegetable oil, then edible oil, then non-edible oil also can be used after some chemical processing. Or in the pure form, or we can blend it with the petroleum diesel as a fuel, and we can use it in the compression ignition engines also. So biodiesel is very simple to use. It is biodegradable, it is non-toxic, and essentially free of sulfur and the aromatics. In fact, you know, Rudolf Diesel. So he was the inventor of diesel engine, and initially he designed his engine to use the peanut oil, and demonstrated its first working prototype on in the month of August 1893, and date was 10th of August. He believed that the utilization of biomass fuel was the real future of his engine, and in remembrance of this event, 10th of August has been declared as International Biodiesel Day. Okay, so this biodiesel is a very good fuel. We can actually blend with our diesel, like petrol or the diesel engine. Most probably we are using in the diesel engine, and those are CI engine, compression ignition engine. Okay, so we are going to see some detail about the biodiesel also. Then next is bioethanol process. Bioethanol simply is ethanol. is C2H5OH, ethanol, is a colorless liquid biofuel, and its boiling point is around 78 degrees Celsius, and its energy density is higher as compared to first or those three. So energy density is around 26.9 megajoule per kg, which is made from those sugar cane, the starches and cellulose. Okay, so this is that bioethanol. We are going to see some process of bioethanol also. Commercially, ethanol is used specially for IC engine with 25% mileage penalty compared to the conventional vehicles. So blend of up to 22% anhydrous ethanol with gasoline, which required no engine modification. Okay, the same engine we can use the blending of the ethanol and the diesel. And it is being used by a large number of automobiles in the world today also. So some statistic is given in your book. The something like Brazil, the biggest producer of sugarcane, and presently producing around 23.4 billion liters of year sugarcane. That is the statistic in 2014, of ethanol representing 25% of the world total ethanol used as a fuel. Major bioethanol programs are also being developed in US, then Zimbabwe, okay, and somewhere in the Malawis. So this is what bioethanol. Again, it's a conversion of this biomass into the ethanol fuel. Okay, we are going to see that process also. Then next, that is sixth number, is a biogas. I think everybody is well aware about biogas. It's organic waste from plants, animals and humans, contain enough energy to contribute significantly to energy supply in many areas, particularly in the rural region and the of the developing countries. Okay, so these organic waste we can use, and we can convert this organic waste into the biogas. Okay, and biogas, which contains 50 to 60% of the methane, then 30 to 40% of CO2, 5 to 10% of hydrogen, then nitrogen, oxygen, and some sulfur content is also there. And if I talk about the energy density, it is something like 23 megajoule per meter cube. You see the difference in the units. Here in the first fuel wood, it is megajoule per kg, then megajoule per kg. Now in number 6, I am writing the unit megajoule per meter cube, because this is the gaseous fuel. I need to use in the meter cube. Okay, means the unit of the volume, right? Then we are going to see the detail of biogas also, that how it is generated and how we can use the biogas, right? Then one more thing that is usable form is given, that is a producer gas. And this producer gas is the woody matter such as crop residue, wood chips, bagasse, rice husk, coconut shell. Those can be transferred to the producer gas. This producer gas is also known as synthesis gas, syngas, wood gas. Again, sometimes it is called as water gas or even blue gas. And by the method is called as thermal gasification of solid fuel. So by that thermal gas, source of the energy, like you may recall that when I started the discussion on solar energy, I started the source of the energy, that is sun. When I talk about the wind energy, I again started with the discussion that how the wind is formed. It's only because of the solar energy and uneven heating of the terrain, right? Similarly, when I talk about the biomass energy, I will first like to tell something about what are those sources of the biomass energy. Like in the biomass energy, again the ultimate source is the sun. Only because of the photosynthesis process, the solar energy we can convert into some usable form, that is the biomass form, and then the energy from the biomass we are going to convert into some usable form like heat energy and the gaseous fuel, liquid fuel, and like that. Okay, so in this slide it is shown the biomass resources. So there are some 5 to 6 resources of the biomass. The first and most important resource is the forest. Okay, so when I talk about this forest, fast growing energy intensive trees, like few examples are shown, like eucalyptus, poplar, pine, jojoba, then karanj, then jatropha. These are all those plants which plants are having very good energy, and that's why these are called as energy intensive trees, right? So eucalyptus is the tree. You might have seen eucalyptus. Some 700 species are there, and the natural species is found in Australia. Nowadays, different countries have cultivated this eucalyptus, and it is very common plant right now. I think in our country also, in our city even, you can see the eucalyptus trees are there around us. Okay, then next is this poplar. In fact, it is one ornamental plant, and mostly it is cultivated in the region of Punjab, then Haryana and Himachal Pradesh. Then this is the pine tree, again a similar ornamental plant, but again very energy intensive tree, and which is generally found in the mountain range. Then this is the one jojoba. Jojoba is actually a North American plant, but right now this plant is being cultivated in our country also, and mostly this plant is found in the area of the Rajasthan, and again this is also very energy intensive tree. There is one more tree that we called as currants tree. So currants is required humid tropics, and this is being cultivated all over the country. Okay, then there is one more tree that we called as jatropha, and this tree generally being used for biodiesel production, and it's cultivated all over India, and major regions are Rajasthan, then Chhattisgarh, Andhra Pradesh and Maharashtra. So this is the jatropha, which is generally being used to produce the biodiesel. So all these are those trees, these are just few examples, and these are fast growing energy intensive trees. I will recommend you, for more information you should log into your Wikipedia pages, and you see the detail about their energy densities and their occurrences, what are their species and everything regarding these trees. Because these trees, just imagine if I have some eucalyptus tree, that is very energy intensive tree, I have the option, I can extract the oil from this tree, else I can produce the charcoal from this tree, then I can cut this tree, and I can convert into the pulp, and that pulp I can use for the palletization process also. So like this, all these tree which have the energy, that energy we can convert into the usable form. So this is that first resource, that is a forest. Now this is the second resource, agricultural residues. Everybody is well aware about these kind of the agriculture residues, like rice husk, then coconut shell, then groundnut shell, then these are those sugarcane waste material after extracting juice from sugarcane. So these are those agricultural residues. Just imagine, in our country there are a lot of agricultural land, and lot of people are doing farming, and we have lot amount of agricultural residues. So all these residues have energy, that energy we can convert to the usable form. Then third, we have energy crops. In energy crops, we want those crops which possess some energy in the form of maybe like that glucose, cellulose. So energy crops are sugar plants, starch plant, oil producing plant. You can see here in the first, the sugar plant is shown, and this is a sugar cane, which is a major raw material source for bioethanol. Then you can see this sugar cane can be used for the different processes. For example, the sugar cane can be used, the bagasse of the sugar cane can be used for boiler, which will give the process heat. Then sugar cane can be used to produce the sugar itself. So that sugar production, in that sugar production we will get the molasses. That molasses we can fetch to the alcoholic fermentation process, and from that you will get the ethanol. So sugarcane can be converted to the ethanol also. Then there is again few plant, like this is one plant which is shown in the second picture. It is a sweet sorghum. Okay, so sweet sorghum is also supplies the raw material for ethanol production, especially during off-season supply for the sugar mills. Then there is again the sugar beet. The sugar beet supplies raw material for the ethanol production. So all these plant and some oil producing plant, these plant can be used for as a energy crops, and these are generally used for production of the liquid fuel like ethanol. So this is the fourth source, aquatic plant. Some water plants grow faster than the land-based plant and provide the raw material for producing biogas or ethanol. And these are those picture of some plants which are the aquatic plant. These mostly include like kelp, then seaweed, algae, and those are being used for production of the biogas and the ethanol. So the next resource is urban waste. This urban waste is broadly classified in the two types. One is municipal solid waste, that is the solid waste. Second is the sewage, it means liquid waste. This waste actually contains energy. So that energy which is contained in MSW or sewage, that can be converted to the usable form of the energy. And that usable form is nothing but your biogas, or you can use as it is this solid waste, like with the help of incineration process. Okay, so I think you people can well imagine that how much amount of the urban waste can be produced in the country, and which is generally being produced. For example, if I talk about the Nagpur, which is a very good developing metro city, and lot of urban waste is being generated on daily basis, right? So nowadays the municipal authority are asking us to separate the waste, like the solid waste should be separated, and that non-solid waste, means gila kachra, that should be separated. So why we are doing so? Because we need to convert this into some usable form. For example, if there is solid waste like paper, then if there is solid waste like some garbage which is having no moisture, so that we can directly use for the incineration process, where we can convert that into the heat energy. Okay, and all this liquid which contains some kind of the moisture, some kind of the cellulose, that we can convert by fermentation process into the biogas energy. Okay, then the sewage. This sewage we can treat in the sewage treatment plant, and that again the water can be utilized for some useful purpose, right? So nothing can be wasted if we convert this everything in the usable form of the energy, and we can do it. And right now government is planning to do it. At the end of this lecture, at the last slide, I am going to discuss about which are those industries or which are those government initiatives who is actually doing the pioneer work in the biomass conversion processes. And chemical engineers, then mechanical engineers, then civil engineers, all these engineers have the very good scope in the renewable energy sector in the biomass energy conversion technologies. So I will discuss that at